All right. Hi, everybody. My name is NikNak. I am an artist. I do many, many things. And this is the Launchpad, Come Play With Me, and Music Leads, and Arts Council England webinar, essentially. So we are going to be talking about what we're going to be presenting, advice and guidance on applying to Arts Council England's funds, the National Lottery Project grants, and supporting grassroots live music for Yorkshire-based music creators and those running music projects in the region too. Hope everybody is having a nice Tuesday evening, and as I know it's been really rainy, but be all right, we'll be fine. So as you may know, this webinar and panel discussion is gonna be finding out more about Arts Council England's role in supporting musicians and music venues, who each of the Arts Council England's funds are aimed at and will be most beneficial to. The eligibility in relation to each fund as well, so you know which one, you know, you probably sit better in and can snag, hopefully. The artists and organisations with experience of applying for and receiving support through those funds, and how to complete and submit your application. So it is a lot, but basically, if you're making, performing, recording music, or working to support musicians, artists, or producers in any capacity, any genre, then this webinar is going to help demystify any queries you have about Arts Council England funding. So we're going to get into it. And I'm rubbing my hands, even though you can't really see that off camera, because, yeah, I'm here. And my laptop's quite high up, and I'm quite sure. Anyway. at the end, or towards the end of the panel too, you'll be able to pose questions to everybody that is taking part as well. So feel free to drop questions in the comment box, wherever that may be on your screen. And yeah, we'll try to fit in as much as we can. But I'm going to introduce the peoples from Arts Council England who are very kindly going to jump on and give a very cool presentation that says everything. So I'm going to introduce to y'all Simon Benger, who is the Music Relationship Manager.
Hey, everyone.
England. Hey, hello.
Okay.
And also introduce Richard Brown, who is the Senior Relationship Manager at Arts Council England. All right, guys.
Hey, hi, Nicole.
Cool. So, can you maybe explain a little bit about what it is that you do?
Sure. Hi, I'm Simon, and I'm a music relationship manager for Arts Council England. I'm based up in our Yorkshire office, and in my role, I speak with applicants to our funds, mainly around music. So that could be anything from artists, bands, record labels, managers, producers, festivals, you name it, giving them funding advice and the best way possible to access our funding so that they can carry out amazing music projects.
Lovely, Simon, thank you. And Richard, what do you do?
Oh yeah, thanks, Nicole. So I'm Richard, I'm a senior relationship manager and I work with a team of people, including like Simon, and I work with local authorities. So I tend to have a more strategic view over what's going on. So I work closely with Leeds, for example. And I'm not just music anymore. There was a point when I was doing music, so I cross art forms at the moment as well.
Nice one. Now, I believe you have an amazing presentation that will go through everything for us, right?
Oh, you're really picking this up, yeah.
I'm the host. It's not a good deuce. It's all a, yeah. Cool. I will leave y'all to it.
Thanks. Cheers, Nick Matt.
Thank you.
Okay, so hi everyone and welcome to this session on Arts Council England funding for music artists and creatives. Thanks for joining us this evening for what I'm hoping will be a really useful session. We get loads out of them, so we hope that you do too. And after this talk, we've got some really great panelists who will be able to give you some absolutely brilliant insight into applying to Arts Council. So please stick around for that. So as NikNak mentioned, this is our introductory guide to our key fund, which is National Lottery Project Grants. as well as its affiliated fund supporting Grassroots Live Music, both of which are really, really relevant to musicians in Yorkshire. But this is going to explain which is the best one for you to choose to apply to. Just before we get going in earnest with the presentation, I just want to say like a really big thank you to Music Leeds for hosting the session and for the fantastic work that they're doing. So thanks Whiskers, Tony, Nicole, of course, and of course Emily, who's running things behind the scenes tonight. And finally, if you've got any questions that come up during the talk, as Nicole mentioned, just please write them in the comments section and we'll try and get them all answered. We really want to focus on project grants and Grassroots Music. So if you have any questions about any other funds, there's loads of useful info on our website, or you'll be able to contact our customer services team who will be able to help you with those. So this session is on how we support music projects and musicians with a focus on the additional support we're giving during COVID-19. While we do award grants of up to £100,000, we'll be focusing today mainly on grants of up to 15K. And this is because they're our most accessible grants and a really great starting point to people who are new to our funding. Can I have the next slide, please, Emily? Great. So here's the agenda for our talk. Firstly, I'll be taking you through what Arts Council is, how our funding works, and what you can and what you can't apply for. And then Richard's going to talk about the criteria we ask applicants to respond to in our applications, as well as how to write a really strong bid. And finally, I'll talk a bit about how we can support applicants with their proposals before answering some of the, you know, some of the questions being posted, and we'll try and get through as many as we can. The ones that we can't, we'll try and respond to in the coming days too. Next slide, please. So let's talk about why you're here tonight. We love getting applications from new applicants creating innovative and exciting music projects. We view artists and creatives as a really essential partner in achieving our remit for providing all people in England with the opportunity to engage in arts and culture, regardless of their circumstance. And we need your applications so we can get money out into the sector so that amazing music is being created. Our role is to support you and to support the music sector to make music activity happen that would otherwise not be viable. We know that some of you tuned into this talk tonight that you'll be approaching Arts Council with anxieties around applying maybe, but just to say that we're here to dispel those anxieties and to kind of demystify the process if possible. We also know that COVID-19's hit the music sector so hard. We actually had a period where we had to close a number of our funds, including project grants, so that we could divert money into our emergency response fund in order to help our artists affected by the pandemic. And we reopened project grants only recently in July with some new criteria. And that's there to just to allow us to support individuals and organizations more flexibly than ever, really at a time when music venues are still forced to be closed or may have only just recently started to partially reopen. And those social distancing rules continue, live performances have to be reimagined and replanned. So next slide, please. So firstly, how we support the music sector. We support the sector in England through a range of different funding sources. And while we'll be focusing primarily on project grants and supporting Grassroots Live Music, I'll just say a little bit too about some of the other funds before we move on, as I think they're pretty relevant still. So firstly, National Portfolio Organisations, or NPOs. These are a collection of 828 organisations nationally who successfully applied back in 2018 to be part of our national portfolio. With this comes 4 years of funding in exchange for delivering on work that meets Arts Council aims. To give you a flavour of the variety of different types of music that we support through this portfolio, there's a small sample of our music NPOs listed in the slide. So we've got NTS Radio, Attitude is Everything, Brownswood Recordings, which is Giles Peterson's label, Jazz Refresh, Generator up in Newcastle, Opera North in Leeds, and I Love Live. There's so many more. it's worth though mentioning that many of these started up applying for project grants for smaller projects and kind of built up to becoming MPOs. I also want to mention Develop Your Creative Practice. This is a fund for individuals, and it differs from national lottery project grants because it doesn't actually require any aspect of public benefit or public engagement, which is a really essential part of national lottery project grants. Generally speaking, if you're applying to project grants, we need you to have an audience of some sort. But in Developing Your Creative Practice, it's a fund for individual creatives who can apply for up to £10,000 to develop their work, perhaps through mentorship or time to write new material or experimentation, whatever that is. That fund has been closed since the start of the pandemic, but we just announced a couple of days ago that it's reopening this Thursday. So that's one for your diaries, 15th of October. It's really great news. And we've made some really great changes to that too. The pre-pandemic budget for that was about £3.6 million per year, but it's had a massive increase up to £18 million this year. So a really good time to get an application into that if you're an individual practitioner or an individual musician. It's also going to be easier to apply than it was previously too. So look out for details around that. We're actually talking to music leads about holding another session like this one, but with a focus on developing your creative practice. So watch this space. It's likely to be very soon, as the first round is going to have a quick turnaround. But anyway, we're going to go on to project grants now and to Grassroots Live Music. So next slide, please. Okay, firstly, project grants. Project Grants is our open access fund, and it exists to be reactive to new ideas, to new talent, and to new approaches in arts and culture. You can apply from £1,000 up to £100,000 to fund arts and cultural activity that may be creating, devising, programming, or managing that project. We support loads of different art forms, so dance, literature, music, theatre, visual arts, combined arts, and creative media too. In the next slide, I'll talk a little bit more about the sort of specific types of music activity that we can support you for. In terms of who can apply then, anybody in England can apply. In fact, anyone in the EU can currently apply to project grants as things stand, so long as it's for work that benefits artists and audiences in England. And when we say anyone can apply, this is really important that it includes individual practitioners. Project Grants is one of the few funding programs in the country that will support individual artists, which is why it's so popular. So pre-pandemic, we'd normally require applicants to bring a minimum of 10% match funding to the projects. But as a result of the changes we've made to the program, there's now actually no match funding required, or at least there's not for the time being. Also note that because of the circumstances resulting from COVID-19, we are really keen at the moment to support applications from individual creative practitioners with a real focus on time to think and to plan your work without really so much need for an audience. We're also really interested in research and development activity, so you know, maybe creating new work. Organizational development activity too, so for businesses and arts organizations looking to change their way of working, maybe because of COVID-19. And then also we are really keen to fund live activity that can be safely delivered within the period of the pandemic, rather than the activity with a start date far in the future. So we're looking for things that are happening sooner rather than later. Okay, next slide, please. So we've talked a bit about what Project Grants is. So now let's talk about the types of music projects we can support and therefore you can apply for. On the slide, you'll find a non-exhaustive list of what you can apply for funding towards. So what you can apply for, it includes developing new material, rehearsing for live events, performances and showcasing, touring live shows, recordings, making creative digital content like music videos, live broadcasts, purchasing musical equipment and instruments. And obviously, as I just mentioned, now that, you know, during this period of COVID-19, for research and development work as well. So it's really any of the sort of stuff that music artists, producers, music creators want to do as part of their music practice, putting gigs on, creating a new EP, doing a tour, loads of different stuff. This is all, you know, quite self-explanatory, but what's important to keep in mind for any application that you want to submit are two real key concerns, and Richard's going to talk more about this, are ensuring that the projects we fund are really high quality and that they contain clear public benefit. This will be a really recurring theme for the rest of the presentation, so just make sure to note those things. Also, just to note that if you're planning on applying for funds to cover live shows or touring, we need to see in your plans that you understand the government or the current government health and safety guidelines for live performances. So good luck with that. You can find further detail on what you could apply for in or on our website. There's loads of really useful information there. We've got an information sheet on music projects, which is really helpful for this sort of stuff. Next slide, please, Emily. Okay, now that we've talked a bit about what we can fund, it's important too to talk about what we can't fund. So here's some of the main things that we cannot fund you through project grants. And it's important, as you don't want to put loads of effort into writing an application just for it to fall at the first hurdle and then need rewriting. So what we can't fund includes music recordings without appropriate plans to distribute work, just buying musical instruments or recording equipment, like software as well, without showing artistic development and substantial public benefit from doing so. Self-promotional activity with no clear benefit to the public. Although, as mentioned before, with COVID-19, you can write applications for time to plan research your new material. And then also activity where the intention is to make a profit. I'll get onto that one because it tends to be a bit controversial. So I just want to talk a bit about these it's my experience that this is where a lot of first-time music applicants tend to trip up. Points 1 to 3 are all instances of activity where there's no clear public benefit. And this is where the applicant is unable to demonstrate that their project is going to provide any clear opportunity for audiences in England to engage with their project. So a classic example is an individual, you know, like a solo musician writes an application to us and they tell us that they urgently need a Mac with Logic Pro to create new music on. But then they've not actually described what they plan to do with the equipment beyond this or how they plan to reach anybody with their music. So in this instance, we'd say that the project doesn't actually have any clear public benefit other than to the applicant themselves, and they're the only beneficiary of the new equipment. And from what we know, there's no real plans to get their music out there even once they've put it together. So we could never fund this because that's just, it's clearly there's no public engagement opportunity through it. And then in terms of activity that's aimed to make a profit or based around fundraising. So this is the one that always seems a bit controversial, as making a profit is really an essential part of many businesses, you know, to exist. The reason is that the rules in place because of a stipulation being for all National Lottery funded projects. The key thing here is that while you can't show that you will be making a profit during the life of the project, i.e. the start and end date you give in your application, there's nothing to say that you can't make a profit from the product of the project following its conclusion. So it's just a matter of showing that with all National Lottery project grants applications that the budget is balanced and there's no more income in the project than there is expenditure. If there was more income, then we'd say that that's making a profit and therefore it would be ineligible. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, so supporting grassroots live music then. Supporting grassroots live music is actually just a strand of project grants. It has the same criteria, but a completely separate budget of £1.5 million, which is ring-fenced to the sole benefit of grassroots music venues and promoters. It covers grants of up to £40,000. You can still apply for over £40,000, but you'd need to do so through the normal project grants route, as you know, that the upper limit for this fund is 40K. Just a little bit of background to the fund. All venues and promoters have been eligible to apply for National Lottery project grants to support projects that help them bring live music to the public. But until we launched this grassroots fund back in 2019, we were receiving really few applications from venues. The grassroots live music sector is really crucial to the development of musicians and audiences across the country. We see it as really like the main talent development pipeline for the music sector. We also recognise that there's some really significant challenges facing the grassroots sector. I mean, venues can struggle to focus on developing the programmes, their audiences and the business models. So as such, we've made this ring-fence part of project grants funding that only venues and promoters can apply to. And by promoters, we mean people who put live music on in venues, obviously. So the current funding round is still open and it closes on March the 31st, 2021. So it's worth starting to think about this if this is relevant to you, if you're a venue or a promoter. In terms of what we can fund through it, we can fund artistic programming and audience development. So for example, we could fund a season of performances or shows across one or more venues. You'd be looking for a project where you're taking risks on programming new genres of music or looking at new ways of presenting live music given the current circumstances. Or maybe you'd be looking at developing more diverse program or audience, changing your audience profile, to create new opportunities. You can apply for funding to develop your venue's resilience and sustainability. So that could be trialing alternative uses of venues during non-show times, maybe offering music-related activities to kids in the daytime. It could be afternoon performances instead of just evening ones. Loads of different options. And then we can also support equipment purchases and small capital works, so building works as well. So in terms of equipment, that could be production equipment like amps, PAs, microphones, lighting, rigging, all of those sorts of things. And in terms of capital work, we can fund alterations to venues to make them more accessible to all members of the public, like lifts, ramps, hearing loops, all sorts of things. The main thing there is just ensuring that the project clearly demonstrates development of artistic activity and benefit to the wider public. Okay, next slide, please. There's not loads to say here in terms of what we can't fund through supporting grassroots live music, because it's essentially the same as National Lottery project grants. The main difference here, I'm just going to highlight the first point, which is that we can't support individual bands and managers or agents through this fund for the reasons that we've talked about. It's just for venues or for promoters. So if you're an individual band or a manager, look to National Lottery project grants instead. Okay, next slide, please. Just one more from me before I hand over to Richard. So this is a general list of what we can't fund and what we could make your application ineligible for if you did any of these things in them. I've already mentioned a few of these, and I'm not going to read through them all because you can read about them in our guidance. But I'll just highlight the two there in yellow at the bottom, which are firstly costs that take place before we're able to. Make a decision. But this is, you can't have any retrospective lottery rules. And by this, we mean activities, including buying goods or services that have started or been bought, ordered or contracted before we make a decision about your application. So an example, somebody's wanting to apply to us for a live outdoor music event. They give their project start date as the day after the 6-week turnaround period, because it takes us 6 weeks to to from the moment that you click submit to give you a decision. From the plan that you've given us, we can see that, you know, day one of the project is the first day of the performance, and there's some costs in the expenditure in your budget which relate to marketing and planning. So you would have already carried out this activity before the start date of the project. We'd therefore not be able to fund it because some of those costs have already happened. It's a bit of a technicality, but it's just worth being aware of. And the other one is underdeveloped. And this is an ineligibility reason that we use more than any other. It basically means where an application doesn't include enough information for us to be able to make a decision on it. The best way to ensure that your application isn't underdeveloped is to read the guidance for National Lottery Project Grants or for Grassroots Music on our website. There's loads of really helpful resources there to make sure that your application is not ineligible. So make sure to have a look at those, please. So these are the same prompts we use to make our decisions. And, you know, we're being transparent and trying to help applicants. So read that guidance and you won't fall, you won't have any issues with it this way. Okay, so I'm going to hand over to Richard now, and he's going to tell you a bit about the application form itself and the criteria that we use and how you can go about writing a really strong application. Okay, next slide, please.
Thanks, Simon. So we're now focusing on writing the application. So our application has four main sections: quality, public engagement, finance, and management. And for quality, this is the great art and culture part of our mission statement. It's about you and your project. Public engagement is the everyone part of our mission statement, and that's the audience that you are working with. Who will engage with the activity and how will they engage? And for finance, it's about your budget, your income, your expenditure. It's about your financial management and your experience of financial management. And it's about fair pay for artists. And management is about when and where will this take place? Who will lead in each part and how will it be managed? And there's a project plan section of the application, so complete that. As Simon said, the how to apply guidance goes through the application step by step. So it's a really important document to look at. And we know your application is a plan, and while some elements, of course, will change, you should have everything confirmed as much as possible or as close to as confirmed as you can before you do submit the application. Next slide, Emily. So quality. In this section of the application form, we want applicants to tell us about their artistic work, some more detail about the activity they would like to do, and how this activity will help them or their organization develop. We also ask about any other artists that may be working with, what their role is, and why they've chosen to work with those artists. So what are we looking for and what should you tell us? So it's important to understand that your application will be looked at by a panel, but none of them may have a specific music specialism. So please don't assume on anyone's knowledge of your particular specialism. They're well trained to understand what a good project looks like from a funding risk point of view. So the more you can tell us or explain, the more confident we will be. So your idea, please be as clear as possible what you want to do. Do state the obvious, just be clear and concise. So your quality, let's keep it about elements of all quality of the project: yours, your artistic collaborators, your materials, the quality of presentation, or the quality of the audience experience. We just want to understand, we want to understand the quality of your project. Tell us about any press, any big achievements you've had, any awards, any notable airplay or gigs, playlists, collaborations, anything that demonstrates your music or project is high quality. With development, who stands to gain what? So project grants is a lottery good cause. and people must benefit. But those people can include you, the artists. So will the artists gain skills or experience from the project? Will the project help to develop the art form or the sector itself? So tell us, why do you need to do this? And why is now the right time? Are you going to try something new? What do you hope to achieve? What would success look like? How will it develop you creatively and professionally? And why do you need that development? What will the impact be on the people that experience the project? Next slide, Emily. So public engagement is one that confuses people, but this is generally just your audience. So what is public engagement? It's everyone part of the mission. This can be any or all of the following: people that attend events, people that take part, people that are listening, people that are streaming, people that are volunteering. So it's engagement with your project. And what are we looking for? So how will the activity increase opportunities for the public to engage in the arts? Who will engage? So is the target audience clear and appropriate? You have to be clear who you're trying to target. Be as specific as you can, whether it's a geographic area, whether it's jazz fans, whether it's an age group, whether it's children, young people. Be specific. And what format will the engagement take? Is it going to a gig? Is it participating? Is it visiting? Is it watching streamed activity? Be clear about how people will engage with your project. And are the marketing plans realistic? How will you reach your audience? And if this, as Simon said about the COVID R&D work, if the activity will not engage people immediately for R&D, then please tell us about how you anticipate you will engage, people will engage with your work in the longer term. So is it going to be a release? Is it going to come to a tour, et cetera, et cetera? Next slide, Emily. So moving on to finance. We expect artists to be paid fairly and appropriately. Sometimes this means paying union rates or agency rates that you've agreed with the agents of the artists. We will take a common sense approach to that, but artists must be paid fairly. And your income is your ticket sales, your money from other funders, your own money, your support in kind. And at the moment, the 10% match requirement is currently lifted. Your expenditure, your artist fees, transport, rehearsal, equipment, insurance, and contingency. So with capacity for your ticket sales, make sure you're taking into account government guidelines on social distancing and venues, be clear you mitigate against those risks. So what are we looking for in finance? Are the finances realistic, achievable, and fair? Is there enough money? Is the expenditure appropriate? We've got lots of experience in looking at budgets. So therefore, if something doesn't look right, it doesn't look right. Does the budget balance, as Simon explained earlier, regarding national lottery rules? Are artists being paid appropriately? That's a key thing for us. Is there a partnership funding support? Is there a contingency? You can put a contingency in, that is absolutely fine to do. And can you manage it? So what experience do you have in managing budgets before? Next slide, Emily. So finally, the management section. And on this one, your partners are the people you'll be delivering the project with. So if you're putting out music, it can be your distributor. It could be your PR company. It could be your agent, your manager, or venues. But it's really important to tell us in detail about the other people supporting your project, because this helps demonstrate that the project is quality and likely to be happen if you have other key partners supporting you. And make sure these partners are confirmed in your application. Of course, in the current climate, there's lots of uncertainties. So it's this section where you can tell us about your plans to combat any risks, particularly from COVID-19. So if, for example, you're planning a concert happening in spring, and as COVID-19 is still a continuing risk, tell us what you will do if lockdown happens again, or if social distance guidelines are still in place. And this is what we call a mitigation against the risk not happening, against the risk of it not happening. For this, we will always take a common sense approach and look at what is realistic, but be clear that you are looking out for these risks and please do mitigate against them. So in management, what are we looking for? Is the project doable and can you do it? So capability, do you have the skills and experience or do your partners? Capacity, do you have enough resources, money, people, equipment, time? And is the activity well planned? And that's where the project plan comes in. Be as detailed as you can. So location, when, where is it happening? And are the tour venues confirmed? And are they appropriate for the size of band you are or the size of project you are? So people often get the project plan wrong. They maybe just make it two or three entries and it's not enough. We need to get a feel from that you understand your planning, that you know when you're going to do rehearsals, you know when you're going to do your marketing, you know when you're going to have your event, whether it's your get-ins, and you're thinking about your evaluation. So make sure you get this across that you are a safe pair of hands for public money to deliver your innovative project. And think about your evaluation from the start as well. Collect information and stats. What do you want to achieve? And then you can measure, did you actually achieve it? Next slide, Emily. So advice and guidance. Before you apply, check that the project you want to apply for is eligible for project grants. Find out, are you ready to apply? Is the timing right? Is your activity well planned? Do you have finance and partners in place? So take the quiz on the website to find out. There's also the how to apply guidance, which we mentioned earlier. Please download that and look through that. It goes through the process in such detail and gives you a really good sense of the type of information and level of detail that we need to see in the application to make a judgment. Our information sheets, as Simon said, provide further help with planning your project, and they're linked closely to Grassroots Music or similar. And our customer services team are the first point of contact for project grants advice. They can advise you on eligibility of your activity, discuss any parts of the application, and help you with the online application form grantium. So relationship managers are there like Simon and I, but with over 10,000 applications to project grants every year, it's not actually possible for us to speak to every applicant. That's why it's really important for us to do webinars like this, because we really want to attract as many new applicants to project grants as possible. Next slide, Emily. I think one before that, Emily. Can you go back one? Thank you. Back again.
I think we've ended up one out of sync here. I think might just be missing one.
Ghost slide, brilliant. Okay, thanks. Next one. The ghost slide is about numbers. So the project grants is in two strands. Hey, there we go. There's the £15,000 and under, and you get a decision in 6 weeks with that strand. And there's the over 15,000 where it takes 3 months, 12 weeks to get a decision. And the project grants typically receive over 10,000 applications per year, of which approximately 80% of these are eligible, and then approximately 40% are successful. But the good thing to know about project grants is if you're unsuccessful, you try again. It's great. We have a selection of artists on the panel later. All of those have been successful. So there's a great mixture of artists that are successful, but not everyone is successful all the time. So they always try again. Next slide, Emily. And the next one.
Just the one on access support, please, Emily. That's the one.
Ah, thank you, brilliant. So finally, some detail and access support is really important. This, the aim of the fund is to ensure that everyone has the same equality of opportunity to access our information and our funding programs. This means ensuring that all applicants can access our guidance, our information, our advice, and our application forms. So this doesn't extend to developing the projects, but so if any access support questions, please email the customer services with any queries and you'll get help. The number which is on that slide, unfortunately, is not available at the moment. Next slide, Emily. And that's us, thank you.
Thanks very much.
Thank you, El.
Thank you, Simon and Richard. That was very informative. I was typing away furiously. So I'm not going to lie. I had a few questions, but that was really comprehensive. It's like, oh, so I can't ask that now because they've said it and I can't ask that. But no, it's good to know. So, yeah, like you say, like if people have applied like before in the past and they may be thinking, I've got an idea or I kind of want to try a couple of things at least with yourselves. I'm getting the idea that it is, like you say, it is worth applying again.
Do you want to take this one or me?
Can you go, Simon?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Really, really worthwhile applying again. You know, as Richard touched on there, our success rate is pretty good for funding body, 40%. But obviously, you've still got a slightly bigger chance of not being successful than being successful. But what you can do by reapplying is think about, you know, what you could have done to improve that application. You know, there's an opportunity to take some feedback from us and then put it in again. So, you know, you're in with a really great shot. I'd really strongly encourage anybody to think about reapplying if they've been unsuccessful. You know, don't let it hold you back. I'd say that nearly all applicants who, you know, applied lots of times over, even like bigger organizations, they always had knockbacks. It's just the way it works. But then, you know, keep on going and I'm sure that, you know, you'll end up with a good result.
Cool. And just before we go and have a break and kind of have a cup of tea and stuff, I just wanted to ask about the accessibility side of things too. So obviously right now, like there's people with like learning difficulties and things like that. And a few organizations are taking into account applying with video. So is that something that is also being implemented or has been implemented?
We obviously, that's an important question. And we haven't got that capability yet, unfortunately, for video submission, but it's certainly something that we are looking at. But with any access support, especially with learning difficulties, then that's where the Access Support Fund comes in, and we recommend the applicants email customer services with their requirements, and then we will hopefully be able to help them.
Cool beans. All right, thank you both. Like I said, I've been typing furiously and my hands hurt. All good. What we're going to do now is take like a 5-minute break. So we'll be back at 8:20. And then we're going to be speaking to the panelists who have received funding and we can kind of have a chat with them about what it is that they used it for. So we'll see you in about 5 minutes. Hey everybody, welcome back. So yeah, if you've just joined us, hello, I am NikNak. I'm a artist, I do many things, basically. But yeah, this is a talk, webinar, panel discussion, all kinds of things with Arts Council England. We've just spoken with Simon and Richard, who are some pretty important people in the squad. And they just delivered an amazing presentation. They have just let me know through the interwebs that they can make that presentation available to people. So if you missed out on that, no worries. Plus, this whole event will be available to rewatch too. So savvy. So we are chilling. We are chilling. So now I'm going to introduce some very special people. Very grateful to have these people come through and join us on this realm that is the interwebs. So we're going to bring those people in and then we're going to talk to them about their approaches, what they used the funding for when they went for certain bits and bobs through Arts Council, and hear a bit about what they do. So firstly, I'd like to bring in through me pulling an imaginary rope or something, bring in Deborah Egan, who is the director at the Diner Venue in Sheffield. Hey, Deborah.
Hi. Hi.
Hello.
Hi, all good.
Lovely. So, Deborah, I'm going to big her up right now, so stand by. Deborah is a musician, sound artist, and the director of the Diner Venue in Sheffield. She, as an artist, she is part of the award-winning experimental sound collective Sona and director of the Diner Sheffield, which I've said already. And am I right in thinking that you were one of the, well, Diner was one of the venues that received funding recently as well?
Dina, yeah, it's Dina.
Sorry.
We have got a Diner though. We've got a Diner. Wore it all shirt, right? Definitely right on all counts. Yeah, we were fortunate to get CRF funding, and we got Grassroots Music funding earlier in the year. But the CRF will help us to deliver the Grassroots Music, if you know what I mean. So it's all kind of conjoined.
Okay, I see. Right.
It's a long story, but I'm happy to tell anybody the story if they don't want to get something that might get a bit bored, maybe.
we can dive into it a little bit. I think that's cool.
Sure.
Cool. Nice one, thank you. And next up, again with the imaginary rope / telekinesis, I'd like to bring in Liam O'Shea.
Hello.
Who is the
hello
he is the creative director of No Bounds Festival, which is also in Sheffield. Sheffield's smashing it. Yes,
yeah.
Liam is the founder and creative director of No Bounds Festival, and he's also a curator, performer, promoter, marketer, venue manager. And you also did a crowdfunder for Hope Works, right?
Yes, we did. We did.
Yeah. How did that go?
That went really well. We got to our initial target. And so, like, yeah, really, really good. And that came in a day before. We also got really fortunate to get the CRF as well. So it's like, it's been a crazy few days for us. So amazing, really. So, yeah, life-changing business.
Amazing. Congrats. So, yeah, we've got two kind of people who are kind of behind the scenes in terms of, like, venues and festivals and doing that side of stuff. But we've also got some artists, too. So very wide breadth. I'm doing this with my hands. Yes, wide breadth of people. So next up, telekinesis, is Bella Gaffney.
Hi.
She is an esteemed folk musician, hails from Bradford, and writes and performs folk inspired songs and original arrangements of traditional pieces. And she's also one of four members in the Celtic bluegrass band, The Magpies. Sick.
Yeah.
Cool. Thank you for joining us, and we'll get into like what you use the funding for in a bit. Last but not least, we have Mikey Lord as well. Hey, hello.
Hello.
Hello, mate.
I was worried for like the last 40 minutes that if I didn't mute it, you'd be able to hear me just drinking my tea and vaping.
It's all gravy, man. It's all gravy. Mikey is an artist with a band called As Sirens Fall. He's a vocalist, in fact. And they have performed all across the UK and Europe and onto festival stages from Bingley Music Live to Download. So, yes, mate, smashing it.
That's a lovely
Sorry?
I said that's a lovely sum up. Thank you.
Ah, you're very welcome. Like, my dyslexia just went, cool. Okay. So, thank you all for joining us. So, I'm going to, like, I've got a few questions down. To be fair, like, what the presentation and what Simon and Richard said before was pretty comprehensive. So, it'd be cool to hear how you all kind of used the funds that you were successful in getting and how you were able to kind of implement that in your work. So if I could start with Deborah, what project did you use the funding for? And then that question applies to everybody, but we'll start with Deborah first.
Well, we applied for Grassroots Music Venues funding, and we wanted to up a bit in terms of the kind of audiences that we were getting and in the structure of the organisation. So we started something called Express, which is for young producers between 18 and 25 from BAME LGBTQ feminine binary backgrounds, just to try and get more representation in the field, because we know from looking at lots of academic stuff that representation is super low. So what we've done is actually create a program of like direct what they call in academia applied learning, but that which means you get in there and you get your hands dirty and you plug things in and you chat to people and you take them a drink and you book them and you do the artist liaison and that kind of thing. So it's not like a 3-year course at university. It's about getting in there and getting on with it, basically. So the program is to work with lots of professional artists. And then for the people that are engaged in the program to become part of our organisation and to run their own festival, which is based on everything that they've kind of like picked up. But we've obviously been properly smacked in the face by COVID-19, and a lot of the plans that we made, which seemed like really simple, straightforward plans about putting gigs on and showing people how gigs work, has kind of like gone to the wind a bit, really. So we're like halfway through it, and we'd recruited and all that kind of stuff. So now we're working out ways, which is what some of the CRF funding will help us do, to actually still make that happen and make it real, but, you know, find different ways of presenting. That's kind of like, I was interested in talking to Mikey earlier about his thing at Keithley, you know, and the kind of like how he felt as an artist about performing but not performing in front of an audience, and how like effective that was. So we're really kind of like testing out that delivery at the moment. Yeah, that's kind of where we are. But we were delighted to get that funding, and we've, you know, we're really excited about delivering it.
Amazing, thank you. Liam, what did you go for?
Mine was project grant. It's been the last few years I've accessed project grant funding to help deliver No Bounds Festival, in particular. And I'm someone that's come in and started, as was mentioned before, like Simon, sort of starting at the sub 15K level, and then starting to kind of like develop what I'm doing, and then also as I'm developing what I'm doing, being able to know how to do this whole process better. And so I've kind of gradually on at this point now, I've gone back, but I was applying for more this year with COVID again. Once I originally at the start of the year gone for the biggest application I've done yet, spent quite a long time on it with a lot of different grants, and then COVID came, bang, all gone, like so many of my friends and colleagues in the industry and artists, etc. I also did a Grassroots one, actually, that went. I went back to square one and reapplied for a smaller project grant. So this year, I didn't get because all the grants were withdrawn because of COVID. Then as soon as they released the new project grants, I applied for one to try and deliver No Bounds Festival this year. Despite everything that's happening, I was like, I really wanted to respond to what we've been through. You know, if there was any way I could do it, and the artists that I'm involved with could have an opportunity to do something, I wanted to do it. So I applied for a project grant to do it. I didn't get through, got knocked back. And so I then went back again to the drawing board, like, and then tried to improve it, worked with my advisors at the Arts Council, who were super helpful, Simon Benger, really helpful. And then in that process, I reapplied again. And just at the last minute, I've got it. And like this weekend, we're doing No Bounds Festival. So because of that, I'm going to be able to do a hybrid COVID secure, COVID proof festival, which is a mixture of really using large spaces for a very small amount of people. And it's exploring different ways of kind of doing network collaborative performances, exploring the ways that we interact with audiences, exploring the ways that audiences in this situation we're in a very imperfect situation, how we turn that into an experience and a worthwhile experience for everyone, the artists and the audiences. So that's what I've used it for this Amazing. Week.
Amazing. Yeah, you've got, yeah, your event starts like this week. So that's, I mean, there's good timing and then there's that. Like,
yeah.
So that's brilliant.
You've got to hold nerves sometimes in the process.
Yeah. All good. Well, thank you. Bella, as an artist, quite interested to hear as well how you and Mikey kind of approached the funding and how you got it. So yeah, what was your approach?
So we've had two types of funding from the Arts Council. Our first one was developing your creative practice, which we got to take us to Canada, where we went to the Louis J. Mears music camp as part of Folk Alliance, which was amazing. And then we've also had a project grant, which was to help us make our debut album and then to take that album on tour, which we got halfway through before we were stopped by, a global pandemic, but you do your best. That funding was absolute game changer for us in terms of making an album, because, you know, it can be so expensive. But similarly to Liam, we applied once for the project grant and didn't get it. But then, because you do get feedback on which areas of your application needs more work, so then we worked on that, turned it around pretty quickly, and yeah, got it on the second time through, which was, yeah, amazing.
That's brilliant. That's really good to hear that you got feedback as well. I feel like sometimes that's one of the scariest things when you put a lot of work into applying for something and then if you don't get feedback, then that immediately just makes you feel like, oh, I can't go again. Then.
Yeah. It's like you feel really dispirited and
yeah.
But if you know what's wrong, you know what you can fix, don't you? So
yeah, definitely. Nice one. Thank you, Bella. And Mikey, what was your approach?
We got a tour offer. We got the opportunity to play with the band from Canada called Sumo Psycho. And it was their UK tour. And it was right around the time we were planning on releasing a song called We Go Down Together. And we kind of realized that we could blend the two and give the song the opportunity that we thought it deserved. So we went to Arts Council to help us because we already had recorded the song. We were just getting ready for the release. We went to Arts Council to sort of help us scale up from what we normally would do and try and make something really special happen, and also put us in a position where we could afford to do the tour, because we weren't at the time. And it saved our skin, really, and it was a wicked experience.
That's amazing. There's a lot of Canada. I feel like Canada's just helping us out. That's amazing. Shout out to Canada. Cool. Okay, so that was really great. Thank you, everyone. We're gonna go backwards. So Mikey, did you apply for the funding before, or was that your first time actually?
Oh, sorry, yeah, I should have said it was a project grant and it was our first time actually.
Okay.
We were really, really lucky actually to get it first time. I feel like I'm quite fortunate. Okay. But it wasn't my first time trying it, So it's the first time I press submit. I'm one of those people that feels like they need to get their head around everything and tick every box in my head before I actually complete the task. And my bassist, Jason, can attest to this, that between me and him, we'd been looking at Arts Council funding for the better part of like 2 years. And I remember sitting on my laptop on holiday, going through the application form for a different project altogether, and then just never thinking it because it got it, never doing it because it just got so in my head. Mm. I ended up looking at other things. This is this first one that we really, you know, that we hit submit on, and yeah, it paid off really well. It was a wicked experience, and we're gonna try and do it again, I think.
Yes, definitely. So did you have, I mean, you mentioned your bassist there. Was it both of you working on it together? That was it?
We found out about it initially because he went to a talk, and I believe Daniel from the Arts Council was at that talk, and he met him there. They had a conversation, and then we sort of started talking internally about how Arts Council funding could really help us. And then about 18 months later, when we got our act together and our ducks were finally in a row, we were able to actually secure some funding for a project and make something happen.
Nice. So what would you advise people that are just watching now? Like,
I'd tell people to make sure their ducks were in a row for any project. So I'd make sure that the song that, or the whatever, the, if it's a musical project, if it's a song, like what we were doing, for instance, if it's something like what we were doing, I'd make sure that the song is produced to the tippest, toppest of quality. I'd make sure the song itself was brilliant. I'd make sure your intention behind it was artistically, you know, sound. I'd make sure you had live dates planned out. Granted, that's difficult right now. I'd make sure you had a promotions campaign planned out, have everything priced up, have everything ready, a full plan ready to go before you even sit down and do your application, so that you're presenting Arts Council almost with a fully fleshed out project. Mm-hmm. So that there's no real room for, oh, this might happen, that might happen, this is penciled in. It's like, no, this is how it is. And I think that will probably help you.
Yeah.
Put you in a better position.
Nice one, Mikey. Thank you. Hope everybody's just typing away furiously, like, yeah, okay, that shit. Bella, you said it before how you got feedback from Arts Council and things like that. So can you tell us maybe a little bit about, like, maybe some of the tips that helped you to kind of get the funding eventually? Like,
yeah, so I think for us the weakness was in the public engagement part of the application. So it was just sort of specifically pointing out that was the most underdeveloped part, that we hadn't really thought it through well enough. And actually, we had a bit of outside help as well from a company called Sounds Just Fine, and a guy we know there is an artist development officer. And I told him, you know, I've had this feedback. What would you recommend? And he was kind enough to sit down through that and look through it with us as well. So, you know, if you have any sort of industry sort of connections like that, I definitely recommend getting someone to look at your project for you, and even just, you know, as many pairs of eyes as you can get on it, because everyone's got different ideas, don't they? So that certainly helps flesh it out, and get it ready.
Cool. And it's interesting as well, actually, you both had the opportunity to, well, I suppose, Mikey, in your case, it was a Canadian band touring the UK. But Bella, in the Magpies instance, you were able to kind of use that funding to go abroad to a camp, right?
Yeah. So that was in the Developing Your Creative Practice piece of funding. We went to Canada to go to the music camp, which was amazing. It was just an opportunity to learn new skills and pick up new music in a different culture. And it's based with the Folk Alliance as well. So that's what we're making industry connections too. So it really was sort of developing the creative practice. And also it was an absolutely amazing time. Can't thank Arts Council enough, because we wouldn't have been able to go without the funding.
That sounds dope. I think that's interesting, because a lot of people I reckon up until you gave your examples there, I think a lot of people just thought, oh, it's just in the UK. Like they might have seen the odd kind of supported by Arts Council on various bits and bobs, but people might have just assumed that it's only in the UK that you can use the funding for. So that's interesting.
Yeah, it does depend, I think, on what you're applying for. I'm pretty sure that if you apply for a project grant and if you want to do touring, then I think something like 85% of your dates have to be in England. Is that, someone tell me if I'm wrong, but I think that's what it's got to be. So you've got to look through the guidance quite carefully to see what you can and can't do. But yeah, in this instance, going to Canada was a goer.
Yeah, that's amazing. Yes, cool. Nice one, thank you. Now, Liam, so I guess the same question for you, but obviously with how No Bounds works and, you know, making sure that it's all COVID secure and the fact that you got the funding like so soon, I'm assuming, like, the fact that you're on this call is just like, wow, you've got some time to have a chat with us before you're probably going to be going back and double checking spreadsheets and everything else.
Yeah, you got it.
Yeah. Oh, psychic. So I guess obviously because COVID is a thing, there is some form, I guess you have to be kind of malleable as to how to navigate things right now. And I'm guessing because you've applied before, you've had I'm assuming you've had feedback and then you've gone back and tweaked it and applied and then gone back and then a lot of tweaking to do. So I guess, yeah, what was your experience of that? And, you know, what has it helped you learn in these times?
Okay, well, I think first of all, this has all been a learning experience for everyone. I think, you know, as on this side and the Arts Council on their side, and we've all been feeling our way through it. The key thing about the making very clear to you with this is, you know, you need to be you need to always be mindful of current government guidance. So everything you have to do has to be within the current government guidance. If there are changes, you know, you've got to report back to them and get things checked beforehand. But with this all comes down to your plan as well. For our particular plan, based within the plan of what I wanted to do, and going back to what Mikey said really well earlier on, just get your plan sorted. You need to have a solid plan sorted before you start the process. It's done. Just come with your plan and then start transferring it to the application. Don't be thinking about it while you're writing it. Have your plan done. And obviously, like I say, look at the thing beforehand. Look at the questions you're going to be asked and then make your plan referencing those. But within the application, my application, I had to make it quite flexible and showing that I'm mitigating different circumstances. And it's certainly within other funds like the CRF and things like that. It's vitally important that you're showing that you've taken all the precautionary measures. You've got a very clear real world view on what's happening out there and that you've got all the appropriate measures in place to deal with COVID. And this is for anyone doing things at the moment, you've got to be aware of that. So it's making sure that you're totally plugged in with all the current advice. And if you can, I made mine kind of flexible. So there is certain income strands that are flexible depending on current advice, whether we can sell tickets in real time, if there's a lockdown, how that affects things, can we go online, how much sort of tickets could you do online, do you do it with a paywall, do you do it with a pay-as-you-feel structure. Think about all these things, about ways that you can make money or not make money, even though you don't technically need any money for this one. You know, it's in the era of COVID, it's like you don't need that 10%. I'd still advise people to always think about this in trying to get some. I think it will only strengthen your application if you can, but don't let it put you off if you can't. That's what I say. But for me, it was about trying to build in as much flexibility, but also this is the idea of a COVID-proof thing, why this is a hybrid festival. I've literally made it as flexible as possible so I can respond to things happening within a couple of days. So that's been my experience of it. It's been like an exercise in elasticity as an organization and for my kind of ability to cope with an immensely changing environment out there. And incidentally, our talk tomorrow is about change. So we've got a talk with some really inspiring people, Majid, Shana Jackson, and Oriol Majumdar, about change, which is quite appropriate for this year. That's me. Anyway, I'm waffling on about that. That wasn't answering your question there, but I'll shut up quietly.
So I cheeky plug. Yeah. That's all good. No, I hear what you're saying. It is having to kind of, be specific, be on it with the plan, have that ready as much as possible before starting to submit, and then keeping in mind that, you know, the guidelines may change and things may happen in the meantime, but if you've got that plan at least and it is as concrete as it can be, then
that's one other thing I would just say, you know, stick to the facts. You know, when you're backing, back up all your points and stick to your facts. If you're dealing in facts and reality, you can't go too far wrong. If you're waffling away, then my feeling is that's not going to strengthen your case. Stick to facts and back up all your arguments when you're doing an application.
That's a bit solid bit of advice there. Thank you, Liam. And Deborah, same for you, I guess. You know, was this your first time applying for the funding, and did you receive feedback, and, you know, what have you learned from it?
It wasn't my first time applying for funding. I've done quite a bit of funding applications and things in the past, but I hadn't done for a long time. So I actually had quite a bit of support from Music Venues Trust, who've been when we did the Grassroots Music Venues thing. And that was kind of like enough to get me back on the horse, if you know what I mean. And I did find them really, really supportive. And I think they've worked really closely with the Arts Council in, you know, trying to make the case for our sector. And we're still seeing friends and colleagues like going by the wayside at like a massive, you know, in a really uncomfortable and difficult way, you know, being part of something that we've all been part of all our lives and all that kind of thing. Anyway, so big up for MVT and the Arts Council for trying to fly this flag and get everybody through this situation. But I mean, from my point of view, I'd say be like, you know, have a unique selling point, be like, really think about being innovative and thinking about doing things in new ways. Otherwise, what makes you different from everybody else? I would say be like, picking up on what Liam and Mike have said, be like super, super clear. Totally nail it before you actually go anywhere near that computer. Otherwise you get caught up in all these horrible, like, too many words, too many characters, all that kind of stuff. You've got to really, really hone it down and check your word count. This is real technical stuff. Always get somebody else to check it, you know, and like idiot check it, because you get so wrapped up in it and so immersed in it, sometimes you can't see the wood for the trees. And it's just really good to get a fresh pair of eyes, even if they're not kind of like tutored eyes, if you know what I mean. There'll somebody say, well, what, you know, what the hell do you mean? That's just gobbledygook, right? Just go do it again. And so that's really helpful. The other thing is, absolutely nail your maths. I'm dyslexic, right? I'm an artist. So I had to this is the real difficult place for me. I'm really good at being creative and, like, I guess, a bit, and communicating with people and all that kind of thing. But the math side of it is just a pain in the ass, really. Excuse me, I was swearing, sorry. But
I've already said shit.
So I get, you know, get somebody else to double check the maths, you know, because I don't have any faith in my maths, but I've learned. I just did the CRF and did all the maths on my own, and if I could do that, man, I could do absolutely anything. But it's been a confidence building thing for me, and it's been about, you know, test it, check it out, bring it back in again. Like Liam said, just keep doing that thing where you just, you know, you're idiot checking and all that kind of thing. Those are my main things, really. Innovation, second pair of eyes, you know, be hard on yourself with your maths to get someone else to check it, and do it offline and then bung it all in the little boxes, you know. But I think, you know, it's just really exciting to be able to deliver ideas that are in your dreams, and that's what kind of this Arts Council stuff can do, really.
Yeah. Well, solidarity then. I'm not gonna lie, I've tried for funding as well, and that part, the budgeting part, I'm just like, this is numbers now. That's interesting that you say that.
I think it's really important. We all ignore it. It's the elephant in the room. You know what I mean? It's like, you're creative, and you know, it's like you don't want anybody to know that you're really bad at maths. because you're really good at doing music. But so you just need to reach out and get somebody else to do. You know how much a gig costs. You know how much it costs to hire a bus. You know how much it costs to get a new set of strings for your guitar. You can like know all that stuff. But you can be underconfident about that, right? So it's always really good to get somebody else to, you know, to go through that for you. I think that's really important.
Mm.
But we're all scared of saying that we're bad at maths.
I'm not. I'm terrible at maths.
Good.
my maths teacher, I asked him if he thought that I should take maths to A level when I was in high school. And he told me that I would bring down the national average. Which, it's not even how averages work, ironically. Even I know that.
Yeah.
He was right.
I bet he told you you're going to be a plumber, right?
He's probably gone in for this whole retrain thing. And anyway, look,
we're all training to be plumbers. Yeah, that's the next one. Right.
We're not going to get into that. That's a different panel. That's a whole different kind of thing. Anyway, let's not do that. Cool. Okay. Well, to be fair, everybody has kind of, through the one question or two questions I asked everybody, everyone's answered all of the other questions that I had. So, sick. I'm going to go to the comments section, or I think Emily, the wizard behind everything right now, is gonna say, oh yeah, there we go. She's giving me a question. Okay, and it's from a person called Mark Young, and he says, is this also available to venues who didn't benefit from the CR fund, please? He says. And yeah, Simon and Richard have jumped on as well. So please chuck all your questions into the comments. Granted, there'll be people that are asking the same kind of questions, so we'll try and, you know, minimize that into like more succinct stuff. Oh, okay. So, oh my God, they're coming on now. All right.
Okay, sure. Yes, absolutely. You can apply for supporting Grassroots live music if you weren't able to benefit from the cultural recovery fund. So yeah, absolutely.
Thank you, Simon. Iona Lane says, it would be great to hear whether there is any reporting artist. It would be great to hear whether there is any reporting on artists have to do following. Sorry, I'm trying to make sense of what she said. Following the funding, and if there was reporting, how did people find it?
So I think that has to do with the funding.
I think what she means is like maybe success stories from people who have had the funding before and what they were able to do afterwards. I think that's what Iona means. Maybe Mikey and Bella.
I mean, what I read there is any reporting like back to Arts Council towards the end of the project. I don't know if I'm completely miles off there, but yes, we did. We did a sort of it was the last week of the sort of project timeline. We did. It was a similar form to the initial application form, but it's sort of a so how has it gone kind of thing, and reporting back on all the initial objectives, whether or not they were achieved, how they were achieved, if anything was changed. Like we had 7 or 8 so we applied for 5,000 and we had 7 or 8 different things that money was going to go on, and over the course of the project things shifted, so we ended up spending more fuel in the van than we thought we were gonna, so we had to pull some money from like the digital marketing budget to spend on fuel, that kind of thing, and reported all that back. So again, it's a like much like having your plan fully fleshed out in detail at the start, make sure that you're on top of it while you're doing your project as well. And then when it comes to filling that bit out at the end, you're not sort of scratching your head thinking, how much did I spend there?
Yeah, not much to add really, but yeah, basically keep a spreadsheet, keep on top of your budget, else you'll be faffing around with your bank account at the end of it, like, where did that money go? But yeah, it's quite a simple form actually, isn't it? It's much easier than applying for funding in the first place. Yeah.
Cool. Thank you both. Mark Jones says, question for Liam. It seems to me how how you complete the application is more important than the project itself. I'm doing my first festival and I'm very confident of it, but not so much with applying. Is it worth getting help to get it written?
Well, I would say, first of all, to that, the content is the most important. What you're delivering is ultimately the most important. It's clearly important how you write it as well, in the respect of getting across what you're trying to do is really important. And it's like getting across an argument really, really well. But this is my case, and making a case, and making a Loctite case for an argument, that's essentially what you're kind of doing here. And if you're not very familiar with, if you're not a lawyer, as I'm not, spent most of my life as an artist, not doing what I do now, avoiding actually sitting down and doing the work a lot of the time, kind of following on from what Deborah was saying, about getting your numbers right and all these things, going down and getting all the details right. That was a process that I found really hard initially. If you know someone who can help you with it, who's been through the process before, great. Work with them, get some help from them. Also, I really encourage you to reach out to the Arts Council, find your relationship manager and work with them. If you are a venue, go to the Music Venue Trust. They're really helpful in being that bridge. But I think in essence, what you're saying there is, I think it's great. It's an intelligent thing to do, to go and try and find help. If you're doing something you're not familiar with, I'd encourage you to do that process if you can find someone to do that. But underneath it all, to me, it's always been about the idea. It's the way you write. The idea needs to be a corker, like Deborah's saying, really good, unique, be innovative, do something really interesting and innovative. And if that idea is really good, and then you combine it with writing it well, then I think that puts you to the top of the list. Get both of them.
Can I add, Liam? That's right. I think that's great. I'd also like to say to Mark that we don't want our forms to be impenetrable, and therefore, we want it to be accessible, so you don't need to get people to help you write it. It's about getting your project across really clearly, and as Liam said earlier, try and avoid the waffle. Be concise, and actually, rather than getting someone to help you write it, one of the best things you can do is you can let someone else read it and ask them if it makes sense, and ask them the question, do you know what I'm trying to do with the project? And if they don't know, you've not been clear. So that's a good way of getting help.
Yeah, it's kind of the same approach with just proofreading and before you know it, you might have actually just made up a really cool group of people that are also invested in it too. So you could be the creative aspect of it. And then somebody else who's really good with numbers is like, cool, I can just do the budget, or I can do all of that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. Somebody else can look into the technical side of things if you're not too well versed, and before you know it, you may have just acquired a little squad of people on top of the people that you're putting into your application too. So yeah, I think I agree with what has been said. Thank you for your question, Mark. Also got one from Jess Shaw. She says, reapplying the second time after being unsuccessful has been mentioned. Does this mean that if you are unsuccessful, you can amend your application and reapply during the same opening, so you don't have to wait until the next one? Or do you have to wait until the next one? I think that's more for the Arts Council peoples.
Yeah, sure. I'm happy to talk about this for you, Jess. If you've been unsuccessful in an application and you receive notification from us saying that it's you've not been successful this time, you can apply again straight away. It counts as a completely new application. It's not an amendment to the one that you just had. But you can obviously use some of the information that you put into that application, into the previous application for this one. We provide feedback for all unsuccessful applicants. So you can use that feedback to improve the application for the second time round. So I hope that helps. It's just the case that, you know, the great thing about project grants is it's open all the time. So, you know, as soon as you've been unsuccessful, you can go again.
Brilliant. Thank you. And Jess also adds, how long approximately did you spend working on your application before clicking submit? Jess, is that for the developing creative practice or for the CRM? You could we can open that up to everybody. So how long did everybody spend on their applications before submitting it? Deborah?
First time when I did Grassroots, I started thinking about it about 2 months before and started just gradually sifting and filtering and all that sort of stuff. And that process gave me a really good handle on how to do it. So then we actually applied for an emergency recovery fund and we were successful in getting it. And I kind of like knocked it out of the park within about 2 or 3 weeks. So gradually, the more I did, the better I got at it, or the clearer it came to me, like what the process was and what was the most efficient way of doing it, and all those things I said about getting a second pair of eyes and getting your maths right and all that stuff. You know, like we're kind of tested. Don't rush it. You know, that's the main thing. If you've not done it before, do not rush it. Consider it carefully and try and cover all elements. Like I think we've all said that, right? Just make sure you've nailed it down as clearly and as in a defined way as possible before you start tapping. Otherwise, you know, it can kind of fall apart. Plenty of time.
Yeah, so. I know. For me, I sweated for a long time when I did my first one. You know, I properly sweated it out. And I agree with Deborah. You know, get the process changes as you do it more and you get more experienced at it. What seems like just an unclimbable mountain at first, as you gradually keep going at it, just don't be put off, just keep going at it and you'll eventually get there. And once you've got over that hill the first time, it becomes easier. But then what can happen is then you go deeper and do bigger projects and then it becomes harder again. But this is, you know, but that's also exciting. If you get, you know, it can be an exciting thing. My thing, I approach this in a creative way now. You know, this is also part of my creativity and outlet for it in doing this and putting on events and things like that. So, yeah, the last one that I did, well, start of the year, my original No Bounds one, I spent 3 months designing the festival and working on grants, this one and some others. But then when I redid the project application after COVID, it was, yeah, that was probably about a couple of weeks. And then when I resubmitted it, you know, that was a couple of days maybe of just like mulling it over, checking, rechecking, passing it to a few people to check, you know, what does that look like? You know, just read it. Just that process, did it really quickly in the end. But by that time, I'd done it quite a few times for the same festival. Just kept trying, kept knocking on the door.
yeah. And Bella and Mikey, how long did it take you both to do your applications before hitting submit?
We didn't have long to get ours in order to factor in the decision time and then any potential grant landing before that tour was going to happen. That I talked about earlier. So it ended up being a sort of, we've been talking about doing this now for 18 months. Let's stop looking at it and let's just do it. And I ended up making countless pots of coffee and staying up all night and filling out the form from top to bottom. And then the following day going back over it and trying not to, you know, address how insane I sounded and sending it off to proofread to a million people, getting it back. And I'm pretty sure we got it done. I sent it to everyone I could think of that might have a mind for this kind of thing. And we've got a bookkeeper for our accounts and had at that point for a few months. So she was able to check the maths for me. And I'm pretty sure we were able to hit submit after 2 or 3 days. But it does seem insurmountable at the start because it's not a small form and it's, I think might be out of character for a lot of artists to sit at a computer and fill out something that feels quite proper, you know? But once you've done it, and if you get the funding, it doesn't have to feel proper anymore. You can do what you do.
Yeah, and Bella?
Yeah, I'm trying to think. It was probably a couple of months. I do feel like I've spent a fair chunk of my life filling out funding applications at this point. But what I always do, obviously I keep them all. Because even if you're applying to different types, you know, if you're applying to PRS or whatever, they often ask similar questions. So you can just go back and grab your old words and update them, and you know that'll definitely make it quicker in the long run. But yeah, the first time you do it, it's a
well, just having that plan, like everybody said at the start, like having like a solid plan, and then just having making sure you've got enough time to make adjustments and tweak it, getting feedback from people before you hit submit. Just having that time there will definitely, you know, aid you as well. Thank you, Jess. Mark Jones has said, just out of interest, will there be another round of cultural recovery, as I didn't know about it the first time round?
Yeah, I can take that. Mark, we don't actually know at the moment. We do know that it's great that some organisations were successful, but obviously some missed out, some were unsuccessful. And, you know, there's certainly some dark months ahead. So my advice would be to, you know, keep in touch, maybe follow the Arts Council Twitter, because that'll be the first one to let you know if this comes out as well.
Cool. Cheers, Mark. Trying to see if we've got any more questions, but I think we've been pretty succinct, you know. We've been smashing it today. I'm just gonna have a look at the comments as well. No more questions. All right, nice one. Thank you, Emily. So I think we're gonna wrap up there, but thank you everybody for taking part in this webinar, seminar, panel, many words that, you know, mean this. Thank you so much for coming. If people want to find out a bit more about just any other bits of advice that they need when it comes to applying for funding with regards to Music Leads, you can sign on to our online advice sessions. Just like there's a Facebook event, kind of rolling Facebook event page, so you can just like sign on there or get in touch and we can sort you out with chatting to a member of the team. With Arts Council bits and pieces, there was an email, like the inquiries email. You can just head to Arts Council website. What is the website, in case people don't know what that is?
It's
my bad. Sorry, I should have said.
Sorry.
Sorry. Richard, what is the Arts Council website?
Artscouncil.org.uk, and the email is inquiries@artscouncil.org.uk.
Brilliant. Thank you. Yeah, thank you all for your time during this weird, we don't even know what it is, but just weirdness right now. But thank you so much for taking the time out and chatting with us all this evening. Thank you to everybody that's watching. And yeah, this will be available to rewatch as well. So don't worry if you missed the start of this or anything. You know, the realm of the internet is weird, so it'll be staying up there forever with my swear words. Yeah, just get in touch. And there'll be loads of people about to help you with any questions that you have. So yeah, nice one, everybody. And we'll talk to you all soon.